Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Astute HR Listen Up podcast. Today, I've got the pleasure of asking David Klaasen back for Talent4Performance. How are you?
I'm very good indeed. Yeah, thanks. Good to see you.
You know, David, you know what we're doing, and it was tremendously helpful. You did this last time. We did a podcast, and it was to do part of a mindset series that we're doing for employers, employees, people that watch these podcasts. And in particular, what I'm trying to do for our viewers is just put some good out there. In the current climate, people need some help. So what we're doing is a series of podcasts with experts in different areas, whether it's the law, whether it's mindset, whether it's accounting or the coronavirus job retention scheme, all different areas. And in particular, what people need, I think, definitely that's the input I'm getting from clients, is they want some direction about what to do, the way forward, how to get out of this hole. So before we get into this particular topic, I love thinking about mindset and understanding that the way you think kind of determines everything. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Why is it that we should be listening to you about this particular topic today?
Okay, well, it's interesting that I've got over 30 years of experience working with leaders and managers about how to develop themselves and become better leaders using psychology and the lessons from the field of neuroscience, actually, because the neuroscientists are now looking inside our brain for the first time, really, in the whole science, the history of science. It's only in the last 10 to 20 years that we've been able to look inside the workings of a live brain, because before they'd cut them up and go, yeah, okay, this brain has got these amounts of cells in it. But now with the sensitivity of the equipment we have, we can actually begin to observe by doing experiments with people, where we get them to think about different things, different emotions, or give them different things to respond to, and then look at the way the brain works. And they're finding out some really interesting things with that.
You know, what you think is what you become, is the phrase, I suppose. And
It is. They're noticing the power of thought and how that affects our emotions and how our emotions then affect our body. And a lot of this stuff, you know, it's ancient wisdom in many ways, because the sages of old said to meditate and to be calm and to think spiritual thoughts to help relax the body and that sort of stuff. And now the neuroscientists are actually beginning to notice that people who do meditation and who do this mindfulness stuff, can reduce their threat levels. And we all know that stress is one of the big, more than ever, you know, from your field, stress is one of the biggest causes of, absences from work, but also of legal disputes. People get stressed and then they don't think straight. And then they go into these legal disputes and you go like, how did it get so bad? Well, because people got stressed.
It's really interesting. A lot of people that don't do meditation don't realize the power of it, in the sense of, you know, maybe they think it's some sort of hippie ohm kind of approach, and it's not. You know, it's taking a balcony view on your life effectively and quieting the static that's in your head to kind of focus on what's important.
And to really bring it, so what I tell a lot of my clients as well is, look, if it's good enough for US Marines as part of their training, it's good enough for me, right? Because it's now they're finding that they've done massive studies with the mindfulness awareness scale. And if any of your listeners are interested in that, that's widely available. You know, I can give it to you and you can give it to them. But it's a very simple little test that can say, you know, how mindful are you being? But they do this test with some training with Marines, and they've done it with loads of different now academic studies. And all the people say that they are then more able to deal with stressful situations. Now, it doesn't remove the stress, right? We still get stressed because that's what the brain does. It responds to stress and threat. But it's the way that you're able to be more mindful about it that it doesn't wreak havoc with you. And it doesn't send you off in a tizzy where you get reactive. You can become more responsive. And that's one of the key things that I think is really important. And one of the key tips, in fact, and that I wanted to discuss really around the power of knowing this stuff and how it can help you in your daily life.
So in this particular topic in today's podcast, David, it's about you're going to give us three tips, neuroscience tips, to help leaders become better leaders. And I think that's really important right now. People want to understand, you know, there's so many different things they're having to deal with. Stressed employees, getting their business out of a hole, maybe a change of direction, maybe a change in the way they're completely changing the way they're operating, or maybe there's losses of headcounts. There's just so many different ways or things they have to think about or decisions they need to make. Tell us what these tips are and how they can use these things to help them in their real life, real time situations right now.
Absolutely. And also, of course, you know, there is also this situation with all this damage being done to business and people losing their jobs, but also a lot of people are losing relatives. You know, they're losing siblings, parents, grandparents. And you know, my mother died just last year, and my father died many years ago, but it's easy to underestimate how disruptive it is when a parent dies. Because of all the stuff that needs to be taken care of, especially if you're an executor, if you're one of the siblings who has to then take responsibility for all the family finances, that can put an amazing amount of stress on people. So one of the things that I wanted to mention was self-awareness. So with understanding a bit about how your brain works, you become a little bit more self-aware and you become a little bit more compassionate with yourself. So because, you know, you've got this brain and it has these reactions. And no matter who you are, you're going to be experiencing that. You know, politicians experience it, kings experience it, and, you know, everybody experiences it from whatever, you know, walk of life you come from.
Yes, yes, yes.
And I'm finding that the more I understand how my brain works, the more I can have A, compassion for myself, and B, compassion for others. And that immediately can diffuse a situation because you go, okay, this isn't personal. It's just my brain doing its thing. So that's the first tip, is to be aware that your brain will do its thing and it'll have these firing reactions, or it'll have these, you know, desire for distraction. At the moment, I'm noticing a lot, you know, there's a lot of working from home. We're in a very sort of, the environment is very same every day. And that means that the brain gets really bored and it wants to look at other things. So a lot more people are finding them being distracted by something where they're looking just for a little reward. Oh, is there anything exciting on Facebook? Oh, is there anything exciting on the news?
Yeah, right.
You know, have you noticed that yourself? Yeah, that it's you're very easily distracted by things now. So it's about having that awareness and being able to go, okay, it's just my brain at work. What do I need to do to stay focused?
That awareness almost separates you from yourself. You're looking at yourself almost saying, you know, what are you doing? And by being aware of what you're doing and observing yourself in a sense, you're able to action things more effectively rather than getting lost in the flow of the or whatever you're doing, right?
That's exactly the point I wanted to make, so that you don't get fired off in the emotions. And before you know it, you're not really thinking anymore. You're just being in your emotions. And that's a reactive state, which isn't particularly helpful.
And I'm getting a lot of that from clients at the moment, just not thinking straight about what to do or what directions to take, and because they're lost in that moment rather than living in that moment, so to speak.
Absolutely, lost in the moment and lost in the tizzy, what I call, or what the scientists call it, an amygdala hijack. And I'll talk about that next, actually, because it's the next tip that I wanted to mention. So Daniel Goldman has written many books about emotional intelligence, and that's also been studied a lot by the neuroscientists to say, like, what is it that makes us more emotionally intelligent? And one of the key things is that when we get stressed, there's a little part of our brain called the amygdala, which is the little sort of point of getting a notice as threat or no threat. And one of the things it does is it fires up the fight or flight response, which means it gets your body ready to take action to either run away or fight something, or even freeze and go like, oh, I'm not really sure what to do here. And a lot of people when the pandemic hit went straight into freeze, like, oh my God, what am I supposed to do? And the whole point about being aware of this is that you can begin to say, right, what am I feeling? Back to what you were saying about noticing your feelings, noticing the sensations in your body and giving them a label. Because here's what happens if you don't give them a label. If you get triggered and you go, I'm saying something to you, and then maybe the screen goes down or something like that. You know, that's a big technological stressor these days, is internet goes down. Rather than getting all stressed about it and feeling that charge of emotional adrenaline surge through your body and then get into a panic, which will actually shut down your ability to think properly, you'll make accidental connections and you won't be able to think clearly, is to calm down and go, okay, I am very stressed by this. I am very upset by the fact that I've lost this connection with this important business meeting or with my family. And that's making me feel isolated. If you can just use little words like that to say, okay, I'm stressed, I'm feeling upset, I'm isolated, the brain goes, oh, it's those things, we've labeled them.
Yep.
And therefore you can begin to manage them and go, okay, that's what's happening. Now let's see what I need to do to resolve the situation. If you don't label them and you go like, oh, this is all awful, it's all really terrible, your brain, your amygdala in particular, is also not only the source of threat responses, but this is the source of memories of threat responses. And it'll go like, where did we last feel this feeling? When did we last feel this feeling? And it'll probably go way back into a time when you were actually quite young and you were stressed about something, you didn't quite have the resources to deal with it, and you'll go into an unresourceful state. That's really unhelpful when you're stressed or when you're needing to solve a problem.
There's a phrase that I use, which says that I've read probably, which is that language shapes behavior. And you're talking about language in your own head, shaping your own behavior and deciding, you know, we're part of this Zoom room group, you know, the CE Inspired CEOs, and they constantly talk about looking through life through a certain lens, and we all have our own lens. And actually, if you just realize that there are other lenses and you stop that internal dialogue that's sort of holding you back, you can actually pretty much become more resourceful and more problem solving than you realize.
And that's, again, another key point that is worth mentioning, that you become, by being able to be aware of what's going on, by labeling it, you become more resourceful. And that's one of the key things that I think your listeners should become aware of. That's the second key tip with this is, when we get stressed, we become unresourceful. One of the ways to deal with stress is by labeling it, improving your emotional vocabulary of your feelings, so you can label how you're feeling.
Yes.
And then being able to be, and that helps you become more resourceful.
Yeah. I mean, it makes perfect sense. I guess a lot of the times it's, how do people acquire those tools and those skills in the first place to be able to do that? And that partly is what you were just discussing about meditation and so forth.
Absolutely. And this is a great conversation, actually, because you're prompting every single thing I want to say with and you're bookending it really nicely, because it falls back to being mindful.
This is not scripted.
It's not scripted at all. No, it's really cool. But do you meditate?
Yes.
Well, there you go. You see, right? So we're coming back in loops all the time, because your brain can quickly listen to and hear and make the connections that I'm discussing and go, oh yeah, it's that, isn't it? So it's funny how a lot of the ancient wisdom of the religions, especially that practiced meditation in the thousands of years ago, are now beginning to go, oh, the scientists are catching up and being able to go, right, this is really good stuff. It's a really healthy thing to do. So I'm very, very pleased that there's that connection now between ancient wisdom and modern science. It's really good.
Absolutely. In terms of practical application, David, I'm sure you've seen this yourself. So, you know, one of the things I say that is, when you're meditating quite regularly and it becomes part of your daily routine, whatever else you're doing, you know, whether it's fitness and what have you, you become more of an observer than a participant. And that's certainly helpful in my skill set. You know, if I get so emotional, not that I don't care, you get involved in your clients' the problems and situations, but you're still observing them in a way, because otherwise you're not being affected for them. So that becomes very practical in making, problem solving, all those sorts of things, right?
Absolutely. You can become more wise because you're seeing what's going on. And you also said something about the narrative, so that you're noticing what's actually happening rather than listening to your story inside your head about what's happening.
Yep.
You're saying, what's actually being said here? How are people actually responding? How am I responding? Rather than a whole bunch of narrative that might be just made up and triggered by other emotions and other things that are happening in your brain, in your life. And then the last one that I wanted to mention, the last tip that I want to mention, because I'm aware of time, is this concept of neuroplasticity. Right, so plastic or plasticity actually comes from being able to mold things or make things. And, you know, plastic, if you...
Oh, David, I think we've lost you.
And neuroplasticity,
David, I lost you for about 2 seconds. So you just started saying molding and plasticity, and then we just lost you for a second. So can you take...
Oh, right. Good. Okay. It's just about that the neuroscientists are now discovering that the brain has neuroplasticity. There are parts of the brain, not all parts of the brain, but there are parts of the brain that can grow new neurons.
Yes.
Right? So we can actually become more intelligent by this sort of practice, right? And when I saw that, I thought, like, oh, become more intelligent. I thought that was a pretty fixed sort of thing. And one of the classic experiments that they found, a very interesting thing with London taxi drivers. And I'm sure you know that with London taxi drivers, the black cab drivers, I don't know where it is now with GPS, but one of the original things you need to be able to do to become a London taxi driver was pass a test called, what was it called?
I can't remember what it was called, but they had to learn all that.
Okay, the knowledge.
They actually had to learn the maps of all the different routes. Yeah. Yes.
They had to know the London, what we used to call the A to Z map.
Yeah, the back of your hand.
Yeah, like the back of their hand. They need to memorize street names and routes to be able to get to anywhere in London. Now, London, you know, London isn't just a city, right? It's a mega city. It's bigger than some of the counties in Ireland almost. It's such a vast area and densely packed with streets. And it's really amazing how when they actually were doing some studies, they happened to have a cohort of the taxi drivers in the study. And then they noticed that their hippocampus was larger than the general population. And the hippocampus is like the routing board for where to put a memory. So when you're having a memory, it'll go through your hippocampus and it'll go, okay, look, this memory has something to do with this, this, and this, therefore located there. And it's like a central hub of where memories go and then get rerouted and recalled. And that is, it's a fundamental part of the brain. And what they found was that there was bigger in taxi drivers. And they were going like, oh, that's really interesting. But then they had to do so much exercise around so much memory. Yes. Which was a really interesting thing. So that everybody went like, wow, okay, so there's this thing called neuroplasticity. And again, I'd like listeners and leaders to think, you can improve your brain power by practicing, by learning new things, by looking, you know, learning a new language. How many languages do you speak, Tosh? Just out of interest. Two. Okay, so do I. A little bit of a third. So I speak, I was brought up speaking.
I'm going to say one and a half.
One and a half. Okay, I could say, I could say two and a half maybe. So English and Dutch, not as fluently as with reading and writing, but I certainly speak it and understand it. And read a bit of it, and German as well.
I know a lot of swear words. Because my parents... Does that count, David?
Sorry?
I know a lot of swear words in different languages. Does that count?
Oh, yes. Okay. Well, that doesn't quite count. But if you learn a different language, your brain has to go through a huge amount of memorizing and labeling and reordering and being able to reconceptualize things in with lots of new words. And the syntax and everything like that. And that's supposed to be really good for your brain. As is, I haven't done it myself with learning a new instrument. So musicians are very helpful. But just doing brain exercises. And as you go back to, if we loop back into the other things around self-awareness and understanding your triggers, is by improving your emotional vocabulary.
Yes.
Learn the words of emotions. Learn the words of the subtlety between feeling irritable and frustrated. Feeling anxious and angry, and what are the different levels of within any particular emotional range? Lots of finer distinctions, because when you have finer distinctions, you can go, oh, I'm this upset, rather than I'm upset. Well, how upset are you? Very. Well, what does that mean? I don't know. That's not helpful, because it's a big on-off switch and there's nothing in between, and that doesn't give you good emotional regulation. And it'll put you into a spin real easily.
So give us a quick summary again, David, just so we can just see. What were the three tips?
Okay, raise your self-awareness. Learn about your brain. Learn about the key parts that have you be able to think properly, which is your prefrontal cortex, being able to understand your brain and how there's a very small, delicate part which does all the thinking. All the rest is below conscious awareness. And there's this piece called the amygdala, which is your firing up of your threat response. And there's another part called the reward response. And just become aware, maybe look into how these pieces affect you. How much are you attracted to rewards? How much are you fired up by the amygdala? And also to notice when you get a threat response. We could do a whole one just on threat response. We could do another talk on that. But it's just to notice when you get the sensations of stress, to label it. That's the key thing, to be able to label it and to be able to then dampen the stress response. Because once the brain has a label for something, it goes, oh, I know what that is. Then let's calm down and think about it. Rather than like, what is it? What is it? What is it? And then the last one is neuroplasticity, being aware of how you can change your brain and you can make new neural connections and even grow neurons with exercise. Expanding your awareness, looking at the bigger picture, looking to new places, new people, finding new things, learning a new language if you want. But that takes effort, and a lot of people don't like the effort.
Yeah.
And I'm suggesting that you take the effort to help improve your brain and keep your brain healthy.
Of course, that makes perfect sense. You know what we're going to do, David? Anybody that has heard this and would like to get in touch with David, his details will go out with this podcast. David, you mentioned earlier about a scale for Marines, in terms of
the mindfulness awareness scale, and what's the best way to be able to get that to people?
You can send me it. Can you send? Is it a link? Is it a web page? What is it, a reference?
It's a PDF.
Okay, why don't you get that to me and I'll figure out how I can get that to people to have a look at it.
Yeah, exactly. We'll do that. And then, you know, people can also contact me as well because we've got lots of stuff on mindfulness as well.
Yeah, so anybody that's seeing this this recording, you'll see it either with this link or if you don't see it with the link, please reach out to us and we'll have it sent to you, no problem.
Yeah, David, and what I can actually do, I've got an idea actually about how to make this work because I've also got an audio download on my website and I'll send you the link for that.
Perfect.
Which is a relaxation download and it's a great place to start practicing meditation. Simple audio download, no cost involved. Pop your email in and we'll send it to you.
Fantastic. David Klaasen, thank you so much for helping us and listening and participating. I love talking to you. We're going to come back again. You know, there's a lot of good, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
People can just, we only need to take two or three things, people. They don't need to do 10 things at once. You know, you only need to sort of start to implement things, little changes that make a difference. And these are experts that deal with these people, with people who have these sorts of problems. So, you know, please do implement them. This is generally, there's no catch. It's generally some good out there that people can use and implement in real life situations. Thank you very much, David, again. Thank you, everybody, for watching and see you again next time. Bye for now.